Tune into this week's episode of the DevOps Lab. We have the Xbox team back again to talk about how they're using Azure DevOps. So tune in. Welcome to this week's episode of the DevOps Lab. This week, we're continuing our series with the Xbox Customer Experiences team, and I want to welcome onto the show, Alan Andrews. Welcome, Alan.
Hello. How's it going, April?
Doing really well. Really excited to have you here because this is the second part of our series, and we're going to continue talking about how you guys do DevOps. So before we get started, can you tell everyone out there what it is you do for the Xbox team?
Sure. So I joined Xbox in about 2016. I'm currently a software or senior software engineer on the Xbox Customer Experiences team. I primarily worked on the Xbox flighting system, so people that want to get like demos of games or the Xbox operating system. But right now I work on the support.xbox.com, the services that help that part of the website.
And this is a really important website that I talk about in a lot of my talks when I talk about DevOps, because you expose the fact that Xbox might be having an outage or something of that nature of what the Xbox system is doing, which is important to people out there because it gives them that visibility that maybe one part of the Xbox system is down, right?
Yep. It's all about making sure that like our whole team's premise is making sure that we give enough support options for customers, whether that's being notified when we get things back up and running, or they need to get like a refund or something, they purchase a game they weren't supposed to, various things of that nature.
So before you guys kind of adopted this whole DevOps mentality and new tooling, can you walk us through what some of the challenges were that you guys had on the team?
Sure. So prior to Azure ADO, we were using an internal system called Autopilot, which is a similar system that, or the same system that Beam uses, I believe, for managing deployments, of managing like your elasticity as far as how many machines that you have. One of the issues that we ran into is that it's just a completely separate system separated from our code base. So you develop like in Git and you would check in, do your pull requests, but then you have to go to a completely different system that would have to have some third party way or a different way or a file shared way to access where your bits were and then to start deploying them out when you wanted to deploy them. So they're just two very separate processes. In addition to that, there wasn't really a good way of like doing automated tests during the deployment process. It was just whether part of the code would go out. We would have these things called health monitors that would check to see if the service was still up and running. But outside of that, there wasn't much else that we could do. Not to mention, again, it was all proprietary. So it was just a lot of tribal knowledge that we had to pick up in order to use. So we wanted to use stuff that was a little bit more mainstream, essentially.
Absolutely. And streamline that whole process. So that you guys definitely had a lot of hurdles to overcome in the team. Can you walk us through how you guys resolved it? What tooling you did, what your new development process looks like using Azure DevOps?
Yeah, sure. So I guess part of the way that we started migrating was that we kind of told ourselves it was too difficult to port our existing services over to Azure DevOps because a lot of the stuff was written in .NET framework and Azure DevOps. We wanted to kind of explore the Azure offerings, which were all .NET Core. Mm-hmm. So we just kind of told ourselves, all right, new services moving forward, we're going to just do .NET Core completely and just build them in Azure DevOps. So one of the pain points that we had was that we needed to rewrite all of our software to .NET Core. We need to figure out a better approach to deploying these things into Azure. So part of that process was we started out manually creating our Azure resources. We would write the service in .NET Core. We would manually deploy it to make sure everything was running. That worked great for a time, but then we had this issue where we wanted to stand up new environments, and it was kind of painful to recreate all those resources again with, you know, mildly different names. So we started exploring ARM templates. ARM templates was a little difficult to understand just because of how obtuse it is. But fortunately for us, like within like a couple of months of us starting to learn ARM templates, Bicep came out and it's like, wow, this is so much better. It's so much easier to understand. So we just started running with learning Bicep and basically just integrating the whole deployment process where rather than somebody having to manually, you know, use Visual Studio to upload the code to an Azure resource, we just built this pipeline, this ADO pipeline that takes care of the whole process of building the code, testing the code, deploying it, making sure that what deployed actually works, and just pushing it out there.
That's awesome. I think you've touched on so many pain points that all of us go through when we're adopting a DevOps process and new culture changes and new tooling changes. And instead of refactoring an old app that could take forever, that you kind of have to go net new and start from scratch. And you look, it sounds like the team adopted some new tooling and all this other good stuff. That's awesome to hear, Alan. Can you take us through what the Azure DevOps deployment looks like and what your process looks like today?
Yeah, sure. So where we'll start out with is we have when somebody does a code change, we want to do testing against that code change before they actually complete their pull request. So this first build that we're going to look at is just kind of showing how we've solved it. It's fairly straightforward if anybody's already familiar with C# building, at least with .NET Core. We have our Git repo that we're selecting, which is just our Git repos inside ADO, so that's not a big deal. We'll have a NuGet restore build. We do produce some NuGet packages for internal consumption, so we'll just do a pack just to see if it works, just in case something breaks on it. We'll run unit tests, and then there's some like internal stuff, this component detection, bin skim stuff. This is just internal stuff to make sure that we're complying as far as compliance goes, that we're not accidentally leaking credentials, that we're not accidentally taking an infected binary and it's just part of our deployment process, so on and so forth. So this is just the part that gets ran when someone tries to check in their code change. Once they complete the PR, at that point, we'll move on to the next part, which is a release build. And the release builds we have scheduled to run once a night as long as something in the code base has changed. So how this starts, so I guess first off, let me run a pipeline so that we can kind of see it go through, but then I'll talk about what it's doing while this deployment is running.
Cool.
So we'll just run, the latest code from master. So while this is running, we will go back to the definition itself, so we can see what the steps are that we do. So very similarly to our PR build process, we still have the restore, we have the build. You'll notice that we have the pack and test commented out just because we were just kind of basing it off of what our PR build used to be. We do have a code signing because normally if we release anything, it should always be code signed to prevent tampering. We do a publish, which basically ensures that the bytes or the bits are configured or organized in a way that they can be deployed to Azure very easily. Because we do bicep deployments, we have a couple directories where we have to copy the bicep out to our staging area. We also have functional tests. So functional tests in this context are deployment tests. So during the deployment process, we'll want to do tests to make sure that this thing is going to actually work before we start switching traffic over to the new bits.
Yeah.
There are also a few things around OpenAPI or Swagger, because when we produce a new service, there are internal teams that may be consuming it. So we just have an internal way of sharing like how to use this service. But then we publish our artifacts to our ADO, I think it's just called an artifacts repository, which makes it available to our release pipeline. So just checking on this will take a few minutes to run, but just jumping over here, this is an example of our release pipeline. So this particular service that we're looking at right now is called Recurrences FB. This is a service that actually, when you're on your Xbox console and you want to see what subscriptions you have available, it queries this service to get that information. So this is the service that we're looking at for the deployment. So what we've done here is we have a lot of stages. And to kind of explain our stage breakdown, it kind of makes sense to explain some background things. One of those being the environments that we have. We try to make sure that when we design a new service that we have multiple environments that we can deploy to. Normally there's a development or dev, there's an integration or int, and then there's a production. In this particular case, just where we were at the process, we felt it was important to have an integration in prod, but not necessarily a dev. But some of our even newer services, we have those three, sometimes four, like a flight also, a place to go to that's all prod, but not actually prod, if that makes sense.
Yeah, absolutely. So maybe like inner ring deployments and stuff.
Yep, exactly.
Cool.
So what we do here is we want to deploy to the int environment first. We've had a pain point in the past during deployments where sometimes a particular process will be intermittent. It'll just intermittently fail. and we want to like retry it because we're pressed for time. We can't get to the root of whatever that airman failure is in the process. So we created basically a stage per large chunk that we wanted to execute, so that in case that chunk failed, we could just retry it very quickly. So even though we have a lot of stages here, one for bicep, one for testing, and so on and so forth, each one is very simple. There's only like a couple of tasks in each one. So we'll jump to this first one for bicep. So at the time that we were learning bicep, there were no dedicated tasks for just doing the bicep deployment. I don't know if that's changed since then, but we could do bicep deployment using Azure CLI. So an engineer on our team took it upon themselves to create what's called a task group that basically tries to parameterize what our bicep deployment is, so that we can easily reuse it without having to like type out the whole Azure CLI command line. So you'll see here that we have a parameter pretty much for each of the parts that we have to provide for our bicep deployment. I believe we can look at the description here. Yeah, so you can see this is the actual description of the task group, where underneath the hood, we're just doing the Azure deployment group create with the parameters that are filled in.
Very cool.
And this made it really easy for us to reuse how we do bicep deployments, where people that are doing it for the first time, they don't have to be intimidated by the fact that they have to go and write a command line to figure it out, in addition to everything else that they're doing.
Absolutely. And I love how you guys have broken up those tasks in your pipeline to smaller chunks. So you've actually taken the services out into more microservices to fit your application stack, so that you have recognized, we hit a failure at one point, it stops our process, we need to continue on, we're time pressured. How you've broken that down is really, really awesome to see, because a lot of times customers ask, how many stages do you use? And it depends, right? How many tasks and stages depends on your app. So it's really cool to see you guys break this down even to more of a microservice approach, so that if something does fail, it's critical, you can push it through and move past it and get through it pretty quickly.
Yep, exactly. So for this next part here, there was actually a very interesting issue that our team ran into, where sometimes when you do a bicep deployment, you are changing you're changing the actual running application without changing the binaries underneath it, basically the service that's deployed. And sometimes that change could actually break what's currently running. So we have an extra step in here where after the bicep deployment, but before we push the new binary onto the service, we'll run our tests against the slot just to make sure, is this going to actually break what's currently deployed? We primarily only do this in our integration environment, because on the production side, it's kind of too late at that point. If we've broken it, that's really bad. We need to get to that point. But what we're doing here is we're just trying to understand ahead of time, does this bicep change actually break backwards compatibility with the previous service that's currently running on the newly modified Azure resource? So here, the tasks are fairly straightforward. In our unit testing, we use environment variables to kind of pick out like what parameters it is we want to use for the test. Mm-hmm. So in this case, we have two environment variables, one that selects the environment int, the other one that selects the region. And this syntax is like a kind of a neat feature in Azure ADO of setting an environment variable that holds over to other tasks in the pipeline.
That you can carry through, exactly. So you can set it once and it'll work it through the rest of the tasks.
Yep. So we use that to set these two variables, and then we just do a .NET test, and the tests that are running will look at those variables to figure out what the parameters are. If that passes, then that means that our bicep changes are at least backwards compatible. We will then do the deployment to staging. I guess one part that I kind of talked past already is that for our Azure deployment, when you create an Azure, like a web app, you have this thing called a production slot that gets created automatically. A lot of people probably aren't aware of. However, we create an additional slot called the staging slot. We want to deploy to the staging slot so that we're not impacting what's currently in production, so that we can test against the staging slot to make sure, this thing actually works the way we think it does. And then we will do a slot swap. And then once we do the slot swap, that's when whatever we're deploying is now actually live. So what we're doing at this part right here is we're just deploying our binary to the staging slot. And then we're going to run a test against the staging slot. Whoops, right here. which again, we're setting the same environment variables, but we're just setting them to different values so that it targets the staging slot URL when it's testing. The tests that we run are exactly the same as the tests we ran last time.
Yep. And then you swap those slots?
Yep, we swap the slots.
Awesome. And using staging slots as they should be used. So that's awesome.
Yeah. I mean, it felt like that was a natural progression of using them.
I think a lot of people struggle to see the use case for it, but it's great to see how you've ran the same test against the staging slot and you just do a direct swap. It's almost like a blue-green deployment effectively. You just swap the slot out and you're good to go.
Yep. And then the final task really is we'll run the test once more against the production slot just to make sure that things are still okay.
Yeah. Awesome. Lots of testing. Great workflow. Looks like you guys have really, really done well in setting this up. And it's been a lot of hard work, but it looks like it's paid off for you all.
Yep. It's been working out really great. I mean, the biggest part about it is the amount of testing that we get without requiring people to do a lot of manual testing. So when we were in the autopilot environment, the precursor, oftentimes whoever was manning the deployment, they would have to do just manual testing. So we just didn't really have a good way of doing it. We couldn't do it during the deployment. But once the deployment was done, someone would have to go and just kind of exercise certain pieces of it to make sure everything's up. With this process, we no longer, because we have tests that can actually exercise that functionality and it happens as part of the deployment, we don't need somebody to sit there and kind of babysit it as it's going through the steps.
Absolutely. And make sure no one misses a test as well.
Yes.
Or it worked on my machine or et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, right? All the reasons something didn't work or was missed.
Yep. And then once after that, one of the things that we experimented also with Azure ADO was having like a gated stage where once integration was done, someone would have to come in and manually approve it to go to production.
Yep.
We experimented with that setup. We found that one annoyance that we ran into was that if we're deploying this every night just through a triggered job, and we want to say move the very latest job to production, because these were set up as dependencies initially, we were forced by ADO to go in and cancel all the intermittent deployments that we did not want to progress.
Right.
And that became kind of a problem because sometimes it might be a week before we deploy, but you know, every single day this thing's generating a new deployment, someone makes a change. So at that point we decided to make the change to just, we have a production line, you have to come in here and manually start it, but at least we can just go and start the one we want exactly. We don't have to go through and manually cancel the previous ones that never got moved all the way out to production.
Awesome. Awesome, Alan. Thank you for showing this to us today and addressing a lot of the same issues our customers have and how you guys have resolved them. So really good to see. So thank you for coming on the show today. And everyone tune in next time. We're going to cover off some more workloads and how the Xbox team have executed them using Azure DevOps and Bicep.